So, thank you, Rupert, for the kind introduction. Don't know if I would agree that I'm a native in immunology, but let's talk about today combining immune checkpoint inhibitors with tyrosine kinase inhibitors. During my talk, I want to give you a bit of a general idea and overview which TKIs are quite promising, how to combine it, what's the rationale behind it. Of course, I will give you a couple of examples, but they are not that important. I think it's more important to get an idea why it might be smart to combine those drugs. And I think you can transfer the knowledge also to future applications. And whenever you come across a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, checkpoint inhibitor, or immunotherapy in general combination, I think you have some idea why we are doing so. So let's get familiar with this pointer. But unfortunately, that's true. There's a bit of a delay. So we will start with my disclosures. As you can see here, I'm collaborating with a couple of pharmaceutical companies, but I don't think this does influence my lecture. I'm not quite sure if this works that well. So after a couple of days, the battery might not be that good anymore, perhaps. Perhaps I can ask you to move the slide forward. Technical assistance from our chair, thank you so much. But it works here. Oh. So you're spoiling my surprise. Okay, it works here, but not at the monitor in front of me, but in any case. If it works here, I hope you can see it online, and of course you can see it in the audience here. So let's start from the beginning, and to give you a bit of a reminder and also of a background, and think it's quite important to understand when we talk about TKI combinations, I think we have to understand the principles and what is the immune infiltration and what is the immunological background of a tumor. As you can see here on the left-hand side of this slide, it's quite obvious that the tumor is infiltrated with multiple immune cells. Some of those cells cells of the adaptive immune system, just think of effector T cells or regulatory T cells. Watch at this pointer really doesn't work. On the other hand, some of those cells are part of the innate immune response. Just think of macrophages or NK cells, for example. If you have a look on the right-hand side of this slide, these are data from head and neck cancer, single-cell sequencing data. What they did, they used the head and neck cancer tissue and had a closer look what type of immune cells are even in there. And they counted about, it's just a snapshot, of course, 140,000 immune cells. And you can see here the composition is quite interesting. In green, there are lots of CD8 positive effector T cells in there, but as I told you before, there are other types of immune cells which are part of the immune cell infiltration of this tumor. But keep in mind, this is not the whole story, of course. It's important to keep in mind that the interaction between those immune cells are quite important. It makes a difference if the dendritic cells present the antigen to the effector T cells, or if not, what is the spatial and temporal association of these immune profiles in this tumor. So of course there's also a time component in there. This is just a snapshot. This is freezed, yeah? But as you know, when you treat patients with immune checkpoint inhibitors, you might increase T cell infiltration, you might alter the composition of this immune landscape. And we do not always capture that in our clinical trials. And when we want to understand immunotherapy, I think we have to keep that in mind. Oh, the pointer works again, hooray. As all of you know, the immunity cycle, and perhaps you have seen some of those slides as well, the immunity cycle is a very important concept when understanding immunotherapy. I don't want to repeat this because I know that you are aware of that. What I really want to point out in this slide that the innate immune system plays an important role, and that's also important later on when we talk about our TKI combination. So the innate immune system, macrophages, dendritic cells, natural killer cells are crucial for the immune response. And the innate immune system is incorporated here in this very famous immunity cycle slide. If you look, I don't know if you can read it, but parts here are written in bold. Those are the steps where the innate immune system plays an important role. So of course, cancer antigen presentation, just think of that also in the lymph nodes. So the antigen has to present it to the lymphocytes. This does not work without the innate immune system. So the immunity cycle just cannot function without the innate immune system. And we must not forget that. Why is there even a need to combine checkpoint inhibitors with other drugs and with tyrosine kinase inhibitors? Why do we need that? So, in theory, the concept of immunotherapy, of checkpoint inhibition, and I know you're aware of the concept of checkpoint inhibition, PD-L1, PD-1, or CTLA-4 inhibitors are approved in our daily clinical practice. They usually work, but in fact, they work just in a minority of patients. You know, depending on the tumor type, we have a 20 or so, on the average, 20-25% of response rate when you use immunotherapy as a single agent. And the duration of response is usually, if it works, it works quite well. But unfortunately, it does not always work that well. And here you can see resistance is really an issue. So in red, we have the primary resistance, the curve, so patients who do not respond to immunotherapy at all. This just does not work up front. But there is a difference between a primary resistance and acquired resistance. And quite interestingly, we quite often talk about acquired resistance. So immunotherapy works, but ultimately the patient experiences tumor progression. But quite interestingly, the definition of acquired resistance is not quite clear. So what does it mean that a patient is secondary resistant to immunotherapy? We have a quite good definition with a TKI exposure or chemotherapy. We know chemotherapy, there is a response or not. We have some patients with a stable disease, but for immunotherapy, it's not really clear what that really means. And there is the definition is still under debate, so it's quite unclear, because some patients who have a stable disease upon immunotherapy, is this not something, is this primary resistance? How long should we accept some stable disease? Is stable disease enough for immunotherapy response? Doesn't it mean if we just observe stable disease in a patient exposed to immunotherapy that we cannot shift this immuno-editing phase to the elimination phase? So, in fact, patients experiencing stable disease, there might be even primary resistance, not acquired resistance. And in addition to that, you have also keep in mind that the tumor is quite heterogeneous. So there are tumor cells which are perhaps primary resistant, but other cells who are quite sensitive, and you select the tumor towards resistance and immune invasion. So I think that's the clinical problem here. And having a closer look about resistance, We know that resistance can occur on the cancer cell itself. So quite obvious, if the tumor overexpresses a PD-L1 or has some mutations in oncogenic pathways, and we will come to that, resistance might occur. But of course, there's also some kind of resistance in the cancer cell microenvironment interaction. So the tumor, for example, secretes TGF-beta, which is quite immunosuppressive. This might cause resistance as well. There's resistance which is attributed to the tumor stroma. Again, a primary or secondary resistance. Quite interestingly, also from a clinical point of view, the organ location seems to make a difference. So especially liver metastasis, they promote a type of immunosuppressive environment which is more challenging to tackle compared to other organ sites, such as lung metastasis, for example. Also, host factors have to be taken into account. And quite interestingly, there are also data that gender seems to matter. Especially, for example, there are a couple of data out there that young female patients that do not respond that well to cancer immunotherapy to compared to elderly male patients. Again, having a bit of a closer look on the immunotherapy resistant factors, we sometimes observe a new antigen loss or a new antigen downregulation. There are data on lung cancer. If you compare squamous cell lung carcinoma and non-squamous cell lung carcinoma, even if they have the very same tumor mutational burden, so the very same neoantigen load, there might be a downregulation of the neoantigen presentation of squamous cell lung carcinoma. And this might be an explanation why immunotherapy doesn't work that well in squamous cell lung carcinoma sometimes. Effects in the antigen processing machinery play an important role, but also abnormal interferon gamma signaling. For example, melanoma cells, 75% of melanoma patients who are primary resistant to checkpoint blockade, they have mutations in the interferon gamma signaling. And keep in mind, interferon gamma might be a double-edged sword. So usually we think interferon gamma, you know, that interferon gamma signatures out there which are, contribute to a response to cancer immunotherapy. But there are also data out there that interferon gamma signaling, and depending on the concentration in the tissue, also might act as some immunosuppressive drug. In addition to that, of course, there's the immunosuppressive tumor microenvironment. We talked about that. Co-inhibitory immune checkpoints can be overexpressed in cancer cells. And that's why we are here today, or I'm here today. Aberrant genomic sequencing might play a role, and we will come into that on the next slide. And I think the next two slides are the most important slides of this talk. And afterwards, I almost could leave the stage, which I won't do, but just to give you an overview about oncogenic events and resistance. So a tumor cell, such as lung cancer here depicted on the left-hand upper side, develops some oncogenic events. You know that. Think of MYC. MYC mutation results not only in PD-L1 overexpression, but also in CD47 overexpression. Perhaps you know CD47 is the so-called "don't eat me" signal. So the cells tells the immune system, I'm a good guy, don't eat me, don't eat me. And I think that's quite important to know when you want to understand resistance to immunotherapy. But as you're all aware of, a couple of cancers and malignancies depend on oncogenic events. Colorectal cancer, for example, KRAS, but this is also an issue in lung cancer, for example. KRAS mutation results in the recruitment of immunosuppressive myeloid-derived suppressor cells. EGFR mutation, we will come to that later, also recruits a tumor immunosuppressive tumor-associated macrophage because the cancer cell can secrete immunosuppressive cytokines. It inhibits cytotoxic T cells. We see that in breast cancer with sometimes a show a P10 loss. Robert Bartsch will correct me if I'm wrong. And we observe it in melanoma with beta-catenin mutations. Again, lung cancer, you know, LKP loss, which has all the key mutations that have been attributed to resistance to cancer immunotherapy, results in some a blockage of interferon gamma signaling, which results also in a downregulation of the Seagull-Sting pathway, which is usually quite important to trigger immune response. But we also observe it in other tumor types. Just think of NOD, STAT, or in squamous cell carcinoma, focal adhesion kinase mutations. So on the bottom line and in summary, oncogenic events modulate the immune system and cause an immunosuppressive microenvironment, recruit immunosuppressive cells to the tumor, and contribute to the immunosuppressive state of tumor cells. So how to overcome this resistance? And we are really approaching now the TKI story, of course. We just have to increase the tumor visibility, and we will talk about, and all of those suggestions, they are modulated by TKI combinations, but we will come to that in detail later. But we have to, of course, we have to increase the tumor visibility. We have to show the immune system, oh, there's a tumor, yeah, there's a don't eat me signal perhaps on the tumor cell, but in fact, it's a malignant cell which has to be eliminated. We have to enhance T-cell infiltration. We have to improve tumor microenvironment barriers. Just think of pancreatic carcinoma, which is really hard for immunotherapy to enter the tumor. We can also manipulate microbiota, and we will touch this later on as well, enhance T-cell and K-cell function, and of course, restore this unfavorable genomic and epigenetic pathways and alterations. Yeah, and I think this is a key slide of this presentation, because especially on the left-hand side, because it nicely shows how tyrosine kinase inhibitors might modulate the immune system and restore and shift the tumor environment towards an immune response from an immune suppressive environment. So we know that in preclinical but also clinical data, PI3K kinase or BRAF inhibitors inhibit the immune suppressive mechanism of the tumor cell. CDK4/6 inhibitors, for example, directly inhibit immunosuppressive cells itself. So they do not act on the tumor cell only, but they also act on the immune cell itself. They directly activate immune effector cells, promote immune effector mechanism, and also, and quite importantly, such as which has been shown with BRAF and CDK4/6 inhibitors, upregulate antigen presentation. In addition to that, and how to overcome a resistance to immunotherapy, and I think Professor Zielinski talked about neoadjuvant immunotherapy yesterday, and I will just touch this with one slide, but I think it's really important to keep that in mind, that the earlier you tackle a tumor, the earlier you target a tumor, the less immune-invasive mechanisms have been developed by the tumor cell itself. So it's really quite reasonable when we combine immunotherapy with checkpoint inhibitors, but also with other different drugs, to move to earlier stages. We know that, we have seen that, and on the left-hand side, and I really want to point out that as well, there is a very sound rationale that neoadjuvant immunotherapy is superior to adjuvant immunotherapy, because the antigen presentation and the immunogenicity of the tumor seems to be much higher if you start with immunotherapy in the neoadjuvant setting compared to the resected tumor where occult metastases may still in the body, which are not that immunogenic compared to the primary tumor. And we have seen that in preclinical data for breast cancer, for example, but also for non-small cell lung cancer, that animals have a prolonged survival if you go for neoadjuvant compared to the adjuvant setting. And on the right-hand side, those are data from breast cancer. And you can see here, this is also reflected in the clinical development program in early stage breast cancer, that the yellow bars represent clinical trials which are conducted in the neoadjuvant setting, and the blue bars are trials which conduct in the adjuvant setting. And you can see here, there are much more neoadjuvant trials out there because I think it's really makes much more sense to do so. Okay. Let's talk about a couple of examples when and how to combine a tyrosine kinase inhibitors with immune checkpoint inhibitors. And let's start with malignant melanoma. As always, melanoma is the prototype of immunotherapy. We learned a lot. And you know that a fraction of melanoma patients are BRAF mutated patients, and BRAF mutations, as I told you before, it modulates the immune system and causes some immunosuppressive state. If you tackle BRAF mutation in melanoma with BRAF MEK inhibitors, and you know this is a standard of care in malignant melanoma, you can really reverse that. You can increase a tumor cell death, decrease immunosuppression, and this is quite interestingly, if you have a look at the right-hand side of this slide, perhaps I can show you now, no I cannot, this is a lymphocyte, and even if you use a BRAF inhibitor, it works with some delay, great, even if you use an BRAF inhibitor in a BRAF wild-type lymphocyte, because the melanoma cell is BRAF mutated, the lymphocyte is BRAF wild-type, no surprise, but what you see and what we see is on the one hand, we inhibit melanoma growth, so BRAF mutate, but on the other hand, there's a paradoxical activation of the BRAF pathway in the lymphocyte, and what we see is that you can observe an increased cell proliferation in BRAF wild-type lymphocytes, therefore increasing immune response. So here we can see what BRAF MEK inhibition in combination with immune checkpoint inhibitors does on the in the immunity cycles on different steps. I don't want to go into detail here, for the sake of time, but what I want to show you is that this concept has been proven to be effective in the clinical setting as well. So perhaps you are aware of the melanoma phase 3 study, which has been published last year in The Lancet, comparing immunotherapy plus BRAF MEK inhibition to BRAF MEK inhibitors only. It was a large randomized phase 3 study, and you know, here is the primary endpoint, progression-free survival, and you can see here in red, a triple combination, checkpoint inhibitor plus tyrosine kinase inhibitors are superior to BRAF MEK inhibition only. With respect to adverse events, there's not much of a difference, and based on this study, the triple combination has been approved in the United States, so this is an FDA approval. I don't want to discuss this study now in detail. I know there are some issues of this trial. I know there are still unanswered questions. I know that it did not answer some sequencing question and many others, but in theory, but also in the clinical practice, the concept of combination does work and showed activity. Also think of renal cell carcinoma. You're aware that VEGF plays an important role in renal cell cancer. VEGF itself causes some immunosuppressive state, so it's quite reasonable to combine VEGF tyrosine kinase inhibitors with immunotherapy, and this has been shown very nicely and demonstrated in renal cell cancer. I think this is one of the most active combinations in renal cell carcinomas, pembrolizumab plus lenvatinib, which has been investigated in the CLEAR study. And again here, the primary endpoint, progression-free survival in red, lenvatinib plus pembrolizumab is superior to sunitinib only. There's also been an overall survival benefit. So obviously, immunotherapy combination with tyrosine kinases show efficacy in the clinical setting as well. But let's move to breast cancer and CDK4/6inhibitors. You know, I don't know if Rupert told you about CDK4/6 inhibitors. Not a word. But I'm convinced that you know that this concept has been approved used in our daily clinical setting, and I know that you use it as well. But just think about CDK4/6 inhibitors with respect to their immunological roles. And what we saw is that if we treat also animal models with CDK4/6 inhibitors, we observe an upregulation of NOH class 1. We observe an increased antigen presentation in dendritic cells. We also observe a selective depletion of immunosuppressive regulatory T cells and an increased infiltration of tumor effector T effector cells into the tumor. So, on the one hand, of course, CDK4/6 inhibitors target the tumor cell itself, but on the other hand, they modulate the immune system. And when you look on exploratory data of NeoMonarch study, which used abemaciclib in combination with endocrine therapy and the monotherapy in only as a second and a third arm, you can also see here on the right-hand side that abemaciclib plus endocrine therapy increases some interferon gamma response, and this is a very interesting and promising concept to combine this with an immune checkpoint inhibitor because, as I told you before, interferon gamma signatures play an important role and might predict a response to immunotherapy. So, but are there clinical and even preclinical data that is, if we combine ABEMA plus a checkpoint inhibitor? So have a look at the left-hand side of this slide. Of course, this is just an animal model, and you can see here in blue control. And the green line is the tumor in the combination arm with ABEMA plus a PD-L1 inhibitor, and the red and purple curves show the monotherapy. So obviously, combination therapy, ABEMA plus PD-L1 is more effective in animal models, but none of you, us, usually we do not treat animals, we treat patients, and that's why you should have a look at the right-hand side of this slide. This has been presented at the last year ASCO meeting, a phase 1 study combining pembrolizumab plus ABEMA in patients, and you can see here in this, it's of course it's a phase 1 study, and that's the primary endpoint was safety, and in fact it was safe, but for us it's more interesting to ask ourselves, do we observe responses? And in blue, obviously, there are a couple of responses, about 30% of overall response rate, which seems to be quite nice. And again, Rupert Bartsch should correct me if I'm wrong, but if you make some cross-trial comparisons, which we shouldn't, if you look at the MONARCH 1 study evaluating ABEMA monotherapy in heavily pretreated patients, of course, we have about 19% response rate, which is numerically lower. And of course, we have to be really careful making those cross-trial comparison, but this concept seems to be quite promising. Unfortunately, PD-L1 again doesn't seem to be a promising biomarker here, because even PD-L1 negative patients do respond. Again, I think transferring this concept into earlier breast cancer stages should be more promising. This is now what type of combinations are currently investigated. You can see here on the right-hand slide of this PI anti-PD-L1, PD-1 checkpoint blockade. And in fact, it's combined with almost everything. But on the upper left-hand side of this PI shows some combination more or less with tyrosine kinase inhibitors. I know not all of those are tyrosine kinase inhibitors, such as PARP inhibitors, which is not technically not the tyrosine kinase. But you can see that this concept is investigated in early clinical, in early breast cancer as well in phase 1-3 studies. So I think I have to hurry up a bit, almost finally, but it's not really that we have to keep going a couple of slides. But you know, in non-small cell lung cancer, initially, there was some kind of enthusiasm to go for immune checkpoint blockade also in EGFR-mutated non-small cell lung cancer. But in fact, as you can see on the right-hand side of this slide, all of the studies more or less failed. So immunotherapy is not that effective in EGFR-mutated non-small cell lung cancer. And the reason for that is, one of the reasons, is that EGF-mutated non-small cell lung cancer cells then not only upregulate PD-L1, they also secrete PD-L1 CD73 exosomes. What is the result of that? We observe an upregulation or an increased concentration of adenosine in the non-small cell lung cancer tissue, in the tumor tissue, and adenosine is a really very immunosuppressive molecule. So if this is in there, and in high concentrations, we observe an immunosuppressive state. So one might think, okay, then let's combine EGFR tyrosine kinase inhibitors with immunotherapy. But unfortunately, these studies, when we have done that, or this has been done, because personally I didn't do that, this has been done in clinical studies. But unfortunately, we observed severe toxicity. So pneumonitis was quite high. Most of the studies were terminated early. On the left-hand side, you can see a phase 3 study with osimertinib in combination with durvalumab, and this has been terminated early as well. They, in fact, did not really observe a safety signal yet, but there were so many studies out there that this might not be safe that they stopped it. And even it's a very, very small sample size, and of course, it's too low to draw conclusions. But in fact, we did not observe some increased response rate when we combine immunotherapy with an EGFR inhibitor in this study. So this did not work out, and we really have to be careful, because this very small study also taught us that even if you go for a sequential approach, and I know in the daily clinical setting nobody would start with an immune checkpoint inhibitor nowadays and with EGFR mutated non-small cell lung cancer in the first line setting, but this has been done, and what they observed that a sequential start with an immune checkpoint inhibitor followed by osimertinib, even if the immune checkpoint inhibitor has already been stopped, causes or can cause severe toxicity, and one shouldn't do that. And I think this really reminds us that if we that tyrosine kinase inhibitors, they modulate the immune system, and when we combine two immunotherapeutic drugs, it might not always be that easy and definitely not always safe. So doing such things outside of clinical trials without any data and safety data might really be harmful for the patient. Almost finally, just 5 slides left, then we did it. Of course, there are not only tyrosine kinase inhibitors with which target the tumor cell itself. We can also think of tyrosine kinase inhibitors targeting only immune cells. Just think of colonist stimulating factor 1 receptor. It's a tyrosine kinase, and it's important tyrosine kinase, which is expressed on macrophages. You know that there are two types of macrophages. The one, the bad guys, as always, in blue, immunosuppressive macrophages, tumor-associated macrophages, which depend on colony-stimulating factor 1 receptor. On the one hand, and the good guys, M1 macrophages, which do not depend on this receptor. Don't want to go into detail here, but it's quite obvious if you block the blue cells, we should, in theory, observe a shift from an immunosuppressive state towards an immune active state. And the studies are ongoing. It's quite early to draw any conclusion, but just to give an example of the principle, combining such TKIs with immunotherapy, and this has also been done with monoclonal antibodies, has some activity. It's really too early to draw a conclusion. Just wanted to show you it's not always necessary when thinking of tyrosine kinase inhibitors to think it just tackles the tumor cells. You can also modulate the immune system with tyrosine kinase inhibitors, not only the tumor cell itself. And really, almost finally, the microbiome. You are well aware that a microbiome or dysbiosis is associated with response to immune checkpoint blockade. You also know these studies about animals receiving fecal transplant of immune-resistant or immunosensitive patients, and then you can resensitize or not the system. But what I want to tell you here is that, of course, tyrosine kinase inhibitors modulate the microbiome as well. On the right-hand side, there's been a very recent publication in renal cell carcinoma patients receiving sunitinib or cabozantinib, and in green there are healthy controls, and you can see here that with administering tyrosine kinase inhibitors, you can modulate the intestinal microbiome, and this might be another rationale why we should combine tyrosine kinase inhibitors with immunotherapy. But I think it's really important for the future that we gain much more knowledge about what we are doing and why we are doing so, because I think we really need biomarkers to address and to find optimal combinations. It's a safety issue, of course, it's an efficacy issue, and just combining two tyrosine kinase inhibitor with immunotherapy might not be sufficient to gain a benefit for the patient, and I think that's the most important thing we all want to achieve finally. So to conclude, I think hopefully I convinced you that TKIs modulate the immune system, but also the gut microbiome, that the combination is promising, but we have to be very careful and cautious, because not all TKI as checkpoint inhibitor combinations are equal, and toxicity definitely matters. Thank you. This is Vienna, for those who could not visit us. Next time, you should.
Thurston, great talk, thank you. Wonderful overview. Are there any questions from the audience? If not, so until the question in the chat will arise. Thurston, being a simple clinician, one of the questions I'm asking myself is obviously, what about the issue with the antibiotic combinations? We have indications for using antibiotics in patients with febrile neutropenia or with colitis, chemotherapy-induced colitis. Should we be more careful in patients on IOs using antibiotics?
So I think there are quite solid data that the antibiotic use might be associated with reduced response to immunotherapy, and I think we should always be careful using antibiotics and go as narrow as possible. But I think we all do that, and as you mentioned, quite often in our daily clinical practice, we just cannot avoid it. I think the most important thing would be that we understand much more about the microbiome, and we know we should gain some knowledge which is the optimal composition of the microbiome and how to restore it when we had to use antibiotics, for example. I think this would be the next step, and just going for some oral or some supplemental supplemental drugs which are out there and eat some bacteria. This is definitely not sufficient, and this does not work. And we saw studies that this might even be harmful, so outside of clinical trials. But yeah.